I'm the Reverend Zayna Thomley. My pronouns are she, hers, and I am so glad that you have chosen to worship with us today.
How does a weary world practice love?
By sending cards and picking up the phone, by practicing empathy and assuming the best for others.
By learning people's stories and finding common ground, by advocating for justice and saving a place at the table.
There are a million ways to practice love.
So today we light the candle of love as a reminder and a charge.
With God's help, may we bring love into a weary world. Amen.
Amen.
We've been singing a sad song for quite some time. The melody sinking with our heartbeats, the lyrics stamped to the front of our minds. You say, sad songs are honest. It's hard to disagree, for sad songs tap us on the shoulder. Sad songs remind us of the 100 different corners of heartbreak that could be behind. But I don't have it in me to sing a sad song forever. So despite the news, despite the aches in my body, despite the phone call last night that says she's waiting for test results, despite yesterday's shooting, despite the unknown and unchanged, I'm going to sing a song of hope. Like a canary in a snowstorm, I don't need another song of what is. I need a song of what could be. So sing with me. Our voices may get drowned out by the wind, but surely someone will ask, was that a flash of yellow in the snow? Was that the sound of hope?
So the readings for today are from the Gospel of Luke, the first chapter. Looks like I'll be playing the parts of both Mary and Zachariah, so you'll have to bear with me. And Mary said, "My soul magnifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God my Savior. For he has looked with favor on the lowly state of his servant. Surely from now on all generations will call me blessed. For the Mighty One has done great things for me, and holy is his name. Indeed, his mercy is for those who fear him from generation to generation. He has shown strength with his arm. He has scattered the proud in the imagination of their hearts. He has brought down the powerful from their thrones and lifted up the lowly. He has filled the hungry with good things and sent the rich away empty. He has come to the aid of his child Israel in remembrance of his mercy, according to the promise he made to our ancestors, to Abraham, and to his descendants forever." In the second reading, "Then his father Zechariah was filled with the Holy Spirit and prophesied, 'Blessed be the Lord God of Israel, for he has looked favorably on his people and redeemed them. He has raised up a mighty Savior for us in the house of his child David, as he spoke through the mouth of his holy prophets from of old, that we would be saved from our enemies and from the hand of all who hate us. Thus he has shown the mercy promised to our ancestors and has remembered his holy covenant, the oath that he swore to our ancestor Abraham to grant us that we, being rescued from the hands of our enemies, might serve him without fear in holiness and righteousness in his presence all our days. And you, child, will be called the prophet of the Most High, for you will go before the Lord to prepare his ways, to give his people knowledge of salvation by the forgiveness of their sins. Because of the tender mercy of our God, the dawn from on high will break upon us, to shine upon those who sit in darkness and in the shadow of death, to guide our feet into the way of peace. The child grew and became strong in spirit, and he was in the wilderness until the day he appeared publicly to Israel." Here ends the reading. May we be blessed with understanding.
Thank you.
How does a weary world rejoice? We sing stories of hope. I still remember, and I think some of you have probably heard this story because I actually have a, I'm not wearing it today, but I have a stole that memorializes this particular memory for me. But I remember the exact moment that I heard that the United States Supreme Court had released the decision that made marriage equality the law of the land in all 50 states. I remember that exact moment on June 26th, 2015, because I was in a conference ballroom with 50 or so other young UCC pastors. We were in Cleveland at the General Synod of the United Church of Christ, which is our national meeting of the denomination that happens every 2 years. We were there with a leadership program that we were all a part of, and we had gathered that morning for breakfast and to touch base on our schedule for the day, which was very full. We were going over the mundane details. We were being reminded of our responsibilities by the people who brought us there. We were making evening plans for when we were done with all of those responsibilities. And in the midst of all of that, one of those among us had picked up their phone and read a news update that came up in a notification. And they couldn't help but shouting, "The Supreme Court just ruled on marriage equality," they said. "My marriage is now legal in all 50 states." Praise God from whom all blessings flow. It started with just one voice in the corner of the room, but we all joined in immediately. Praise God, all creatures here below. Praise God for all that love has done. Creator Christ and Spirit one. By that afternoon, there was a tent set up on the mall outside of City Hall in downtown Cleveland, and a line of UCC pastors ready to marry anyone who wished. 8.5 years later, it's hard for some of us to imagine a world where some families are treated as second class by our government, though we know that that is still true. And many of us know how long that road was, even though it seemed to turn sharply and quickly. And many more know that that fight isn't over. So how does a weary world rejoice? We look back on all that God has done, all that love has done, all that those faithful few who went before us have done, and we sing songs of hope. Paul Lawrence Dubnar penned these lines that are coming up on the screen as part of his poem called Sympathy. You might recognize the final line from being used in a pretty popular book and well-known book. "I know why the caged bird sings," he writes, "ah me. When his wing is bruised and his bosom sore, when he beats his bars and would be free, it is not a carol of joy or glee, but a prayer that he sends from his heart's deep core, but a plea that upward to heaven he flings. I know why the caged bird sings." It's said that he, a black poet at the turn of the 20th century, wrote this poem when he was working at the Library of Congress. He was the son of formerly enslaved parents, and he was there working in a particularly dull position, he wrote. And he felt caged day after day, unable to imagine something better, something more that he had hoped for. Our theme this season, How Does a Weary World Rejoice, is a line plucked from a French hymn, and some of you might have picked this up, written just a few decades before this poem was penned. O Holy Night, right? We know it. You might remember the line, a thrill of hope, a weary world rejoices. But there's a later verse. Truly, he taught us to love one another. His law was love, and his gospel is peace. Chains shall he break, for our slave is our brother, and in his name all oppression shall cease. These songs that we've heard in Scripture, that we sing in preparation in the season of Advent, these songs of our faith from one generation to the next are not just gentle Christmas carols. My soul magnifies the Lord, Mary sings. My soul magnifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God. God has noticed me, a lowly servant. To everyone else, I'm nobody, she says, but not to God, and not anymore. From now on, all people will know that I am blessed. As soon as her also pregnant cousin Elizabeth blesses her, Mary sings about a God of liberation who pulls down the powerful and from their thrones and lifts up the lowly. Mary sings a story of hope, one in which justice and joy are interwoven, are inseparable. You see, the two, justice and joy, come hand in hand. Joy and justice. Mary begins by praising God in her song, but the lyrics move quickly to being a song of witness and challenge and charge. A song proclaiming the world God doesn't just dream of, but that the world that God is actively creating in her life. God has scattered the proud in the imagination of their hearts, brought down the powerful from their thrones, and lifted up the lowly. God has filled the hungry with good things and sent the rich away empty. God has come to the aid of God's children. God has paid attention to the weak and the vulnerable. You see, Mary's song isn't just one of praise, it is one of resistance. One that both acknowledges the pain of the world and in stubborn defiance proclaims that something else is possible. One that acknowledges and comes from her place as a poor Jewish woman living under the brutality of Roman occupation and holds at the same time the hopes of God's promises, the promises that everything can and will be turned upside down. The powerful will fall, the hungry will feast, and the rich will be sent away because they've already had their fill. Now, Mary learns this song quite obviously from her ancestors. We don't have to look very far in the Hebrew text to find the song of her ancestor Hannah in the book of Samuel. Hannah, upon receiving good news in her life, sang, "My heart exalts the Lord. My strength is exalted in God. The bows of the mighty are broken, but the feeble gird on strength. Those who were full have hired themselves out for bread. Those who are hungry are fat with spoil. The poor are made rich. The poor are raised up from the dirt. And just a few minutes or a few verses after Mary echoes Hannah's song, Elizabeth, her cousin who she had visited, has her own baby. Now, the father, Zechariah, who's been unable to find words since he first learned about their journey to parenthood very late in life, bursts into song, overcome with joy, blessing his newborn son, John. He says, "And your life will be prophetic, dear child, and you will prepare the world for God's love. And you will teach the people about forgiveness and mercy, and they will know joy, and they will know light. And that light will guide us in the way of peace." He too sings a song of hope, bolstered by joy and a commitment to justice. I have no doubt, and I was reminded about this in preparing for today, but I have no doubt that I was one of just many Christians who went to church around the same time, Sunday, December 16th, 2012, just 2 days after the Sandy Hook Elementary School shooting, and wept when we sang. We sang a familiar Advent hymn, particularly in this verse, "O come, now day spring, come and cheer our spirits by this Advent here. Disperse the gloomy clouds of night and death's dark shadows put to flight." You see, songs of hope are audacious and they're stubborn, and some might call them foolish. We read Mary's song this morning knowing the full story, knowing that while Jesus grows to live out God's love in this world in profound ways, we know that he grows up to fulfill many of the things that Mary is singing about. He teaches about this love that turns the world upside down. He ensures that hungry crowds go home full. He brings healing and belonging to the sick and ostracized. He brings hope to an occupied people. We read that story knowing that while Mary will be at the cross when he dies, she will also be at the empty tomb when he lives. So how does a weary world rejoice? We rejoice by singing hope in the face of hopelessness, by singing abiding joy in the face of death, by singing of justice when injustice rages to this very day. And this is not some small thing, singing these songs together. It's perhaps some of the hardest work that we are called to as people of faith. But it's hard in two very different ways, and I want to lift those up because I think they both apply to some of us and maybe all of us. First, they're hard because I imagine that many of us here in this room, we are not enslaved or lowly. We enjoy places of comfort and privilege, particularly when we're looking at a global scale. I'm a white, highly educated homeowner with a family nearby to help me raise my child, and I never question whether we will have enough food for my family to eat. In fact, I know we'll have enough food for our family to eat what we want, not just what we need. Those who were full have hired themselves out for bread. I'm not sure how I'd fare if the world was turned upside down. And yet, the songs of my faith are songs of radical reordering. You know that saying about newspapers, that they exist to afflict or comfort the afflicted and afflict the comfortable. I think in this moment we can call Mary a reporter and wonder if we are the comforted or the afflicted. And yet, it's hard in another way. Because at the same time, despite my privilege, despite my comfort, I am weary. And I know I'm not the only one. I'm weary from living in a society that glamorizes the hustle. That constant pull between our society's emphasis on production and God's demand that we rest. I'm weary from taking COVID tests. Still, 4 years after the start of the pandemic, I'm taking COVID tests to determine if I can be here with you in the place where my heart most wants to be on a Sunday morning. I'm weary from the reminder that writing this message brought of the Sandy Hook Elementary School shooting, and that it was 11 years and 3 days ago, 4,022 days total. And yet, in the decade that followed, the number of school shootings in our country tripled. And did you know that there will not be Christmas in Bethlehem this year? In the Bethlehem. There's a lot of other Bethlehems, but in the Bethlehem, the one on the West Bank, where our stories tell us that 2,000 years ago, Mary gave birth to Jesus in a stable with ox and hay and the stench of both. In Bethlehem, where the community of Christians and Muslims and Jews who lived there were welcoming Christian tourists on pilgrimage for generations, where lines usually wrap around the block every December, except for this one. In Bethlehem, the local churches, Catholic, Lutheran, and Pentecostal alike, all came together and agreed that they wouldn't hold services this winter, given the ongoing war. I'm weary from this heartbreakingly conflicted and violent world. And I'm weary from my own paralyzing inability to fully understand it, let alone do anything about it. And yet we sing. I think it's important to remember that we don't sing in spite of our weary hearts. We don't sing to contradict or to hide our weariness. We sing to fortify our weary hearts, to feed them, to heal them, to join them with one another and with God's promise for a new and better way. We sing because singing makes us stronger. As individuals first, but also and especially as a community. It connects us to one another and to all of creation and to all of history on a cellular level, inviting us to join in the reverberations of God's song that echoes from the very beginning of time. Beloved, how does a weary world rejoice? We sing. Even when we're tired. Even when our voices are quiet. Even when we can't hit the notes. When we don't know the words. Or don't believe them enough to say them out loud. We hum along, letting those who do know them take the way and lead. Now, please, I beg of you, if your heart is too big, your heartbreak is too big, if it doesn't even allow you to hum, I beg of you to show up and listen. to listen and be and know that you are not alone. Let someone else sing for you for as long as you need. Let me end first, not with a song, since you've already been tortured with my voice, but with a poem of a voice that has carried me, and I think many, for years. This is Mary Oliver's "I Worried." She writes, "I worried a lot, not that the garden will grow, or I worried a lot. Will the garden grow? Will the rivers flow in the right direction? Will the earth turn as it was taught? And if not, how shall I correct it? Was I right? Was I wrong? Will I be forgiven? Can I do better? Will I ever be able to sing? Even the sparrows can do it, and I am, well, hopeless. Is my eyesight fading, or am I just imagining it? Or am I going to get rheumatism or lockjaw or dementia? Finally, I saw that worrying had come to nothing, and I gave it up. And I took my old body and went out into the morning and sang." So friends, will you sing with me? Just one line, we'll sing together. So we have a few announcements for this life that we live and move in together in a weary world in a holy season. So first, a reminder that we have a second service today at 4:30 this afternoon. It will not be live streamed, but it will be here in the sanctuary. This service for those longest nights is a recognition that those who grieve and carry heavy burdens through this season need some space to hold and to feel them when the world so often expects us to rejoice. So that service will take place this afternoon at 4:30, and all are welcome. After that service will be our youth Christmas party from 6:30 to 8:30, so we're very different feelings, but likely different crowds as well. If you have not signed up your youth yet, it's not too late. Please do RSVP by noon today so we can be sure to have the right amount of food for all those joining us. It's going to be really great. Today is the last day to bring in coats, boots, and pajamas for the warming tree to go toward Way Forward Resources, formerly Middleton Outreach Ministries. You'll see the coat out in the hallway. We've already gotten a ton, so thank you for everybody who's brought those. But if you're coming back this afternoon and you have forgotten until now, you could bring something to add to that, and it will still get taken in on time. Today is also the last day of the Fair Trade Sale. Your purchases at the Fair Trade Sale provide income to marginalized artists living in Java and in Indonesia by promoting craft development in areas where land and employment are scarce. Your support helps families stay together by reducing migration to cities for employment. We're featuring some of the beautiful nativity scenes that we have this year. Through the sales of their products, artisans receive training in financial and business skills, help with medical expenses, emergency disaster relief, school scholarships, and loans. The artisans use raw materials from sustainably managed sources and support conservation projects, including tree planting. So your Christmas shopping can do good in many, many ways, especially because all of the proceeds from our Fair Trade sale this year benefit Heart Room, which provides wraparound services by empowering and supporting families and their children who have experienced homelessness to move into stable, long-term housing. And you will see, today is the last day prices have been reduced. Everything must go because we don't want to store it till next year. So please feel free to stop by during fellowship today. Next Sunday is Christmas Eve. There will be two services. Just a quick reminder, these are not the normal times that our Christmas Eve services happen, so pay attention. Because it's on a Sunday, we will have a 9:30 a.m. service and a 7:30 p.m. The morning service will have a special children's message, and the evening will be led by our large, wonderful choir who has been practicing and rehearsing for weeks now. Both services will have professional musicians. Both will be lovely and wonderful, and we hope that you will come to the one that best fits your schedule. At those services, and beginning today, we will be accepting donations for the Christmas Fund for our Christmas special offering. You can read about that in your programs or online, the United Church of Christ Christmas Fund, and we'll talk more about that next week. But just know that you can give to that online starting today on our giving platform. And on that note, thank you. Thank you to everyone who continues to financially support Middleton Community Church and all of the good and all of the singing that we do here together. You can give offerings as you leave worship today through the boxes that are on the walls just outside the sanctuary, or by going to middletonucc.org and finding the yellow donate button. Friends, let's sing together one more time. Please stand as you are able. So we sing Angels We Have Heard on High. Now, my friends, I invite you to turn toward these doors that I remind you are not an exit, but an entrance into a week of joining the song, of singing together, and of knowing that we do not sing alone. As you go from this place, may God bless you and keep you. May God's face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. And may God look upon you with kindness and to give you peace today and every day. Amen.